Hi, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, your host on Inspire Nation. If you've ever wanted breakthrough ideas and incredible creativity, then do we have the Net and the Butterfly show for you. Today, I'll be talking with Olivia Fox, author of The Charisma Myth, and Judah Pollack, both former faculty members at Stanford StartX and the authors of an incredibly creative and entertaining new book on breakthrough ideas, The Net and the Butterfly. And that's just what I want to talk with them about today, about the art and practice of breakthrough thinking. That, plus we'll talk about showers and the Rolling Stones, Superman and Moses, phone calls and Jewish mothers, oy vey, staring at vacuum cleaners, the importance of climbing trees, Casablanca and We Are the Champions, unruly chickens, flying notebooks and pens, and what in the world Texas Generals and Charlie Brown Christmas trees have to do with anything. So welcome to the show, Olivia and Judah. Are you both ready to shine?
Yes.
Woohoo! And Olivia, are you ready to shine?
Your intro was fantastic. I'd like to steal that, but then all of a sudden, it went all quiet.
Interesting. So we'll see how the technology hangs in there with us today as we're doing kind of this threesome from, I'm not quite around the globe, but different locations via Skype. So we'll see how it goes.
We're doing a threesome already. Now that's one we hadn't done on air yet.
That's a whole different level of creativity.
Yep.
Wow. Let's go with StartX first. What in the world is StartX?
StartX is a Stanford Student Enterprise Accelerator. Essentially, you can think of it as a little hothouse of future companies.
Very good. And both of you started working together there?
Oh, no. Judah, you want to tell the story of how we met, or shall I? Because my version's better. We both know that, but apparently yours is more accurate.
You can feel free to tell yours. Print the story.
So the differences are very small. We were both invited to a party, which both of us being introverts, we really didn't want to go to, but we're both dragged to. And what I remember is walking into the room and just my eyes scanning the crowd. And then they hit upon Judah, who was just standing in a doorway, and my radar for extraordinary people just went berserk. I crossed the room, planted myself in front of him and said, "Tell me about yourself. Because you're extraordinary, and we're going to be friends." And that was, probably now close on to a decade ago, I guess.
Yeah. And Judah, would you add anything to that, or correct anything, or uncolor anything in the story?
The only place where I differ is that I believe that Olivia was already at the party, and I had walked in and kind of barely crossed the threshold and just planted my shoulder against the door jamb of the entrance, literally, to not go in, and sort of stayed there. And that's when I saw her sort of lock onto me and start coming at me. And I'll admit to being a little fearful at first. I was like, this woman is walking straight at me, and I have no idea why. And she was wearing snow boots in the spring. And
it was cold. I was on a bike, and I was in a cocktail dress. Yeah. They go together well.
Snow boots and cocktail dresses. That's going to give us an idea where to go. So you both have always been creative people then.
Well, this is where it gets really interesting. I've never seen myself and still don't see myself as a quote unquote creative person. It's a label that in my mind has always applied to the artists, the musicians, you know, those people. Mm-hmm. I am more comfortable with labels such as resourceful or ingenious. Those I can work with. So it's a question of embracing whatever label works for you.
Well, I almost hate to go there, but is this something to do with your childhood that you weren't called or considered creative? Because clearly you are creative.
But let me tell you why. It's about France. So let's talk about the French. I was born, bred, and raised in France, and creativity in children is not encouraged. If you look at the school system, it's actively discouraged. So that may well have been why. The summit, the most prestigious French jobs you can have are always in the civil service. And the absolute highest, hardest post to get is head of the IRS, the French IRS. So that may give you an idea as to how just how creativity is embraced in France.
I never thought about it. I went to school. I was racing bicycles in Europe, and I finished off college in Aix-en-Provence. And the family I stayed with looked at me as an idiot. and I thought it was because of my poor French skills, but I clearly was an out-of-the-box thinker, and my host dad was le professeur. So,
well, you were up against something else, which is that there is some background prejudice against athletes. You can't be an athlete and be intelligent. Since I was a competitive swimmer in high school, my French high school teacher told me that quite obviously I would end up as a garbage collector. It's either you're a brilliant scholar or you're everything else.
What's interesting when we take it to today's topic, and we want to talk about breakthroughs in creativity, but it kind of goes along with this, is oftentimes the people who have these paradigm-shifting ideas are the ones who are not coming at it straight on, that are not coming through the traditional cumulative, you learn from what's just been learned and what's just been learned before that, but are coming way outside of the box and on a giant arc to get there.
Judah actually had a beautiful sentence. Now, just to let you know our process, Judah usually says some brilliant things and then totally forgets them. And then when I quote them back to him later on, he says, "Oh, that's great. Who said that?" And I'm like, "It's you, you idiot." one of the things he said was something to the tune of, "The great leaps in our knowledge are found not by people who look for answers, but for those who have the courage to stand in questions, the uncertainty of questions."
That makes sense.
So being willing to stand outside the box is indeed one of the prerequisites to innovating anything.
And that's the most, whether it's a French culture, whether it's an American culture, and we're in 200, I looked yesterday, 202 countries. I thought it was just 200. It is, for some reason, at this point on this planet, and I believe we're evolving and we're growing upwards, but at this point of the cycle, it seems to be a time, while there is a lot of innovation, that stand-outedness towards innovation seems to almost be frowned upon.
Can you say a little more about that?
Yeah. Playing outside of the sandbox, for instance, in school, would be frowned upon today. That we are trying, it's a little bit, seems like, at least in the educational system, not college, before that, more homogenized now than ever.
Yes, and I think there are a couple of things going on. One is that we definitely have a tension point in today's day and age where we're pushing collaboration, mm-hmm. and we're pushing diversity, and so having diverse groups of people collaborate together, and there comes a very natural sense that for somebody to go play outside the sandbox, or somebody to go off and do their own thing, is somehow flying in the face of that collaboration that you're not giving to the group. And so when they have children in school today working in groups, they work on a question with like four of them or six of them around a table together.
Yeah.
I know that for me as a natural introvert, that sounds like hell. I want to be able to have the time to myself to think, to sit with something. And so I feel like while collaboration is a wonderful thing and diverse teams are wonderful, that sometimes the pendulum is swinging a little too far. And we need to allow for the collaborative elements to be given their due and to be held up as a flag to follow. And at the same time, leave space for people to have the quiet introspection, to let the ideas roll around. Because very often it's the mixture between those two styles that creates the really big breakthroughs.
That makes sense. In fact, I can see I'm thinking of myself who on air, I don't sound like an introvert at all, but I have my wallflower aspect to me. You put me in a party situation and I'm the quiet guy off in the background until people figure out who I am. And all of a sudden there might be a bunch of people coming over to me. But if I want my best ideas, I have to go out to nature. I have to go to the silence. I have to get away from all the voices that are around me. Then I can bring it back and we can ping those ideas off of each other.
Exactly. And what you're doing is you're both accessing the creative breakthrough network in your brain, mm-hmm. and you're also mimicking it in your interactions with other people. So the reason you need to go off by yourself is because you need to be off task. We live in this machine age world where we're constantly doing things. We're answering emails at midnight. We're answering them at 6 a.m. We're on our phones, even when we take vacation. And because we're always doing something, the network inside our brains, which we call the Genius Lounge, because it's a network of about 10 different regions that all start talking to each other. And they specialize in things like empathy, error prediction, future forecasting, personal memory, historical memory. It goes on and on and on. And that turns on and really starts motoring when we're off task, when we're not focused on something. So when you're taking a walk in the woods. So it's when we go off and walk in the woods and take ourselves off task that this network, you know, turns on the espresso machine, so to speak, and starts to really pump out novel connections, novel ideas. However, you need new information to spark these novel connections. So from the brain network point of view, you go and you read interesting books, or you go and you talk to interesting people. And so that's what you're doing. You're going out into the woods and you're coming back and talking to people. It's the back and forth that we talked about that really leads to the possibility of having a big breakthrough.
I love it. There's a technique I like to teach people called automatic writing. And people get up, they meditate first thing in the morning, get to the computer. I actually like them to put it on the computer using this app called Flux, put it on darkroom mode. So there's almost no light coming off of the computer. And I want them to get into almost a half awake state and write without thought involved. And this is chapter two. You talk about this with the chrysalis and trying to down-regulate the executive network of the brain to just kind of get the ideas flowing without thought involved.
Yes, and it's hard in our day and age because the executive network really has prominence. We believe in it. It is what gets this world moving. It is how you go places. It's how you remember to pick your mother up at the airport. It's how you remember to pick your kids up at school. It's how you remember to answer all your emails. This is how we are productive. So there's this value we place on productive thought, mm-hmm. and accomplishment and achieving goals. And we haven't really allowed ourselves in the modern day and age to recognize that there's this other way of thinking that our brains actually are pattern recognizing below our level of awareness. And we need to give ourselves the time and the space to access that part of ourselves, because that's where our breakthroughs come from. That's where our creativity comes from. There's a famous story about Salvador Dali, who would sit in a chair and hold a metal key, like an iron key, old-fashioned key, in his hand and put it over the arm of the chair with a metal plate on the floor. And he would start to doze off to take a nap. And when he actually fell asleep, his hand would release, the key would fall, it would hit the metal plate and wake him up, and he would start drawing whatever was in his mind at that moment. And the reason he did this was because in that state of falling asleep, what we call the hypnagogic state, the executive functions go quiet, you're not goal-oriented, and suddenly this other way of thinking comes online, and you start to process all these novel connections and new ways of seeing the world.
Can you tell us about, I love the connection between the two, but what you call the EN and the DN, and how you really want to feed the executive network. You kind of give it what do we want to call it, the building blocks of it, and then rather than assemble it, step back and away from it and see what starts to get assembled for you.
Exactly. So it's not that the executive is fundamentally in the way and you want to get rid of it. The executive is what focuses the DN in order to help it move forward. It focuses it on a specific task. So the great example we use is about Keith Richards. And
yes.
the Stones were touring North America in 1965, and they're not the Rolling Stones as we know them. They're not the coolest kids on the block. They're sort of a mid-level band, and they know that they need a hit. They need a breakthrough hit, something that's going to be a number one song played on every radio station. And Keith Richards, who's the main songwriter, is trying to think of it. So his executive is on task, right? He's trying to think of a hit song. However, the executive was not going to be able to come up with the song by itself. And so as it turns out for Keith Richards, one night in his motel room as he was trying to record a song, he just fell asleep. And he wakes up the next morning and he notices that his tape recorder has recorded a full hour and is now at the end of the tape, just making that little click sound when it can't go any further, for people who remember such analog devices. And he rewinds the tape and it's 59 minutes of him snoring. However, the first minute are the opening bars of the song Satisfaction. And he's just singing very quietly. And, you know, and he doesn't know. He's like, where did this come from? He literally had come to him while asleep. He had woken up, recorded, and fallen back asleep. So it's not that we're taking the executive network out of the equation. The executive network has a very important role in focusing the default network. And it's called that because it's the network in our brain we default to when we're not specifically on task. So the executive network is important to both focus the default network. It's important for bringing new information into the default network, and that new information is going to act as a catalyst. And it's also important because it is involved in discernment. It helps the default network decide, is this idea a breakthrough or not? Because your default network is coming up with stuff all the time, but we don't always become conscious of it. It's not always brought to our level of awareness. It's only certain things that come to us in the shower, for instance, and make us go, aha, that's it. And the executive network is involved in that. So there's this working between the two of them that is incredibly important. It's the dynamic that we need to develop.
So how important is it then of getting, quote, off task or, quote, not productive?
It's one of the key elements. And it's something that we as Westerners are not very good at. We feel exactly that. We feel it's unproductive. We feel it's not helpful. In school, we start to cut recess time. Even though every study tells you that children perform better when they're given recess, when they're given more free time. And it's because it's during that free time, it's when we're playing, it's when we're napping, it's when we're what we call mind wandering. That's when our brain is actually taking all the new information we have and it's making sense of it. It's discovering new ideas with it. It's opening up to other places.
How would you say we access either the hypnagogic or the hypnopompic state?
So one of the best ways to access the hypnopompic state is to just go to sleep, but not because it's the waking up portion, the hypnopompic. Mm-hmm. But the key is to focus your mind as you go to sleep. So you don't want to run around in anxiety. You don't want to not be able to fall asleep. But what you want to do is you want to get yourself into a relaxed state. Mm-hmm. And then you want to ask yourself, so what's the essence of the problem I'm working on? What's the essence of what I want to have a breakthrough about? And then once you have that, that question itself will focus your mind and then just let it go. As you start to wake up, you are in an in-between state, a liminal state, mm-hmm. and the default network has more access to you consciously than it ordinarily does when we're in a waking state, and it starts to deliver all kinds of new information to you. And very often it delivers new ways of seeing things. It may not deliver a breakthrough on the level of relativity, but it may deliver a breakthrough on the level of, oh, this is what I need to say to my spouse, or, oh, this is the way forward with the project, or, oh, that's the problem I've been having with my boss. And it's very important to write it down because in the moment, just like a dream, it's very, very clear, but it can fade very quickly. And so you're writing down whatever it is that the default network is giving you, whatever new insight, whatever new possibility. And then it becomes the job of the executive to look at that new idea and decide, well, how do I take action with this? How do I put this into the world? What's the plan? The executive network is very good at taking action, whereas the default network is very good at seeing a new possibility, showing a pattern. And so again, it's the two of them working in concert that allows you to have the wisdom, so to speak, that the default network can deliver, mm-hmm. and then the means to enact that wisdom in the world, which is the executive network.
Beautiful. From there, let's talk briefly just a little bit more about mindless activities. Olivia, what do you end up doing with either your iRobot or vacuuming robot?
This was not at all a deliberate. It was actually in the writing of this book that I noticed that I often just idly stare at my Roomba, and the front of my mind seems to be somewhat a little bit occupied with trying to predict where it's going to go, what it's next going to do, where it's going to bump into. But in the back of my mind, I can feel something else churning. And in many ways, that is very similar to the experience you have in the shower, where your executive, your front office, is just busy just enough with activities like showering, scrubbing, which you've done so often that very little attention is needed for them. It's just enough to keep the front office busy while the Genius Lounge is getting all the power.
That makes sense. On that note, maybe I know Judah had just mentioned relativity a minute ago. I've always thought of Einstein both getting his best ideas when walking and with shaving or brushing his teeth. Maybe you both could share about Einstein so we can put this in perspective, that it isn't thinking of the problem. That's kind of the theme we're getting so far. It's not the act of thinking that creates the greatest breakthrough.
Correct. And just to be clear, thinking is incredibly important. We're not saying it's magic and just, you know, just go and play in the forest and voila, you will have breakthroughs along the lines of relativity. However,
oh, Judah, I but you want them to play.
Oh, I know. But it's, again, I want to just be very clear that it's both.
Yes.
And it's always the back and forth. And so Einstein was working on his first paper, the special theory of relativity, for 10 years. For 10 years, he'd been trying to understand the nature of light. He'd been trying to understand the nature of time. He'd also been trying to understand what was the philosophical direction he was allowed to take towards asking these questions. But his breakthrough came when he gave up. His breakthrough came when he was done and he went home and he went to sleep. And it was in that way that when he gave himself the freedom to think about whatever he might think about, and he gave his default network the freedom to really roam, that's when the idea came. And then again, he wakes up in the morning after giving up, goes to see his friend, and he says, you know what? I've got it. And then he goes home, but now he spends the next 6 weeks writing out the theory. So he spends 6 weeks with his executive network making sense of this big, huge breakthrough that his default network had delivered to him. So again, we see the connection between the two.
Makes sense. Can you tell us what is, you have an interesting acronym here, I won't even pronounce it right, Lou Miami.
It's Lou Miami.
Thank you.
Lou Miami, and it comes from Bill O'Connor at Autodesk, who has a great accent. It's sort of like a mix between a Boston, New York accent. So he's always like, Lou Miami. It's like, okay. Sort of sounds like you're at a poker table with him. And he has something called the Innovation Genome Project at Autodesk. And they studied innovations throughout history and broke it down into seven main pieces that tend to create innovations in the world. And so it's an acronym. And so you can look at something in a new way. You can use something in a new way. You can move a part of it. You can interconnect pieces. You can imagine different things, and each of those breaks down into seven more. So, i.e., you can look at something from a 30,000-foot view. You can look at it from the point of view of a child. You can look at it backwards or upside down. And really what happens is in these seven questions, and there's six or seven sub-questions, you get a map, a checklist, if you will, for helping you be more creative. And it's funny because many creative people are going to balk at the idea of there being a checklist. They're going to balk at the idea of putting any structure to the process whatsoever. But in reality, there's a lot of structure to the process of creativity. And this is a wonderful one, even for highly creative people, because the creative process is tiring and it wears you out. And by opening yourself to the idea that you can go through a checklist, it can spark new ways for you to go and save some of your energy when you're sitting there going, what should I do next? I'm blocked. What should I do next? You can actually look at the checklist and be like, huh, well, okay, hang on. What could I move in the thing that I'm working on that might make a big difference? And it works in a very powerful way to spark new ideas.
It's making me think of the movie, I think it's called Big Hero 6, and there's a kid who wants to get into robot school in this animated movie, and he's hit a roadblock. He can't come up with the idea, and so his brother, his bigger, older brother, takes him and hangs him upside down by his feet, and he's looking at the world in a different way. He's moving in a different way. He figures out how to interconnect things in a different way, all by stepping back.
it's exactly how it works. And I think a lot of people know that. And one of the things that we tell people to do is dress like somebody else for the day. And so we live in a very dressed down world. We live in San Francisco. So for men, I'm like, wear a suit and a tie today. And just be aware of A, how it feels on your body, because physical sensation is directly connected into your default network. Notice how people treat you. Notice how people say hello to you. Notice how they smile or don't. Notice if they're intimidated or not. Notice what they assume about you. And for women, if you tend to wear dresses, wear pants, or vice versa. If you tend to wear heels, wear flats, or vice versa. And just notice the difference. And just that small change puts you in a different frame of mind and will spark other ideas.
Fascinating. Let's talk more about novelty then. And you have an amazing chapter, chapter 5, Cultivating the Garden, which is really getting things going for that creative process, or getting the brain to be more creative. How do we practice brain plasticity?
Olivia, do you want to jump in? Do you want me to keep going?
No, you do it. And don't forget the couch potato thing. He always forgets the couch potato thing.
Okay, so the important thing to understand about brain plasticity is that it's a physical structure in our brain. Mm-hmm. Our thoughts are literally physical structures. They are built by different neurons connecting to one another. And what happens is we're all very plastic when we're children, because we keep learning. The whole world is brand new and everything is fascinating. And little by little, as we grow up, we start to get into ruts and we start to do the same things. We go to work the same way. We eat the same foods. We listen to the same music. We watch the same movies. And we get out of shape within our brains. And so people who tell you that, well, I'm not creative, it's not that they're not creative. Every human being has this creative engine in their brains physically. It's that they're out of shape. So it's the equivalent of saying, of sitting on a couch for 2 years and then trying to do 10 push-ups, not being able to do one and saying, well, I guess I'm just an out-of-shape, weak person, right? And we know that's not true. We know you need to build up the muscles. You need to practice. And the same is true around creativity. There's no such thing as somebody who's simply not creative. Mm-hmm. It's going back to your first question about Olivia, was she told to not be creative as a kid or not? Very often people are told that as children and they believe it, and so they stop practicing. And then they lose the muscle and it becomes a negative reinforcing loop. So to recognize that you have the ability to build these muscles is the first important part. And the next important part is being open to doing things differently and to realize you can start very slow. So literally taking a different route to work, mm-hmm. so that you have to concentrate a little more on the route, so that you're seeing different trees, you're seeing different curves in the road, you're seeing different stores, you're seeing different sky. This is one of the ways to start the process of building up on your plasticity. Watching a movie, this is one of my favorites, watch a foreign movie but turn off the subtitles and see if you can figure out what's going on. It forces you to engage in the movie in a different way. This one is a very difficult one, but I highly recommend it, which is read a political article from a political vantage point you don't agree with. And that's a very challenging thing to do.
That's supercharged.
Yeah, especially right now. And I'm not very good at it either. But in terms of forcing your plasticity to really see the other point of view, it's a very powerful one.
Judah, let me just jump in for a second. For the past couple of months, I've been almost exclusively reading the news from Breitbart and occasionally Fox News. And when I really can't take it anymore, you know, I'll jump onto some sanity like the Times. But it's absolutely fascinating indeed your brain starts, you can feel in your brain how differently the other side's viewpoint works, mm-hmm. or frankly not, but I'll pass on that one.
But what's cool and what you're saying here is talk about getting out of your comfort zone to really shake up how those neurons work.
Yeah.
I was just going to say that it shaking up how they work is an excellent way of thinking about it, because when you're taking in that information that's new, that you haven't encountered before, you are literally forcing your neurons to connect in ways, physically connect in ways they have never connected before. So there's a mirror here where when you're doing something completely new and different on the outside, you're forcing something completely new and different to happen on the inside. And the more you practice that, the more you build the muscle to then have a creative or breakthrough thought to build a set of connections inside that's never been connected before.
That makes sense. It's making me think for some reason, has to do with creativity. People like myself who claim, and I know this is a limiting belief, I know it's bogus, who claim the best drawing that I can do is a stick figure. It may be to get myself outside of my comfort zone for ideas where I'm going, I'm stuck, I don't know how to move forward, to go start doing some drawing and see what come up to force me completely out of my default settings.
Absolutely. And one of the interesting things about something like drawing is that, so the way that we are able to control our muscles is that our brains send signals down our nerves to our hands and our arm, which then move the pencil, let's say. And there are these protein matrices that connect the nerve from the brain to the muscle in your hand.
Yeah.
Your ability to be strong or your ability to draw is completely dependent on the strength of the connection between that nerve coming down from your brain and the muscle. So that's why practice is such an important element to this, because when you practice, you're actually building the strength of the connection. You're building the ability of the brain to tell the hand what to do. And so when you just say, oh, all I can do are stick figures, and you don't bother to try something new, and you don't really practice, then it's true. All you can do are stick figures, because you're not building up the muscular and protein matrix connection that enables your brain to tell your hand what to do.
We've had Anders Ericsson on talking about, the word is spacing me, peak performance. And
yes.
And we've talked about how if you give somebody a basketball and you say throw it in the hoop and they've never played before, they say, I'm terrible at it.
And we're primed to do that. It's a terrible situation. We don't, and this goes to some of the later chapters where we talk about how do you handle fear? How do you handle the prospect of failure? Because you can't be creative and you can't learn anything new without the prospect of failing and having to deal with your fear around that and how you're going to be seen.
Let's dive into that. Well, finish what you're saying, then let's dive into fear and the inner critic, but go for it.
Oh, no, go. We're ready to go. Olivia?
Olivia, talk to me about our fun inner critic.
The second half of the book is indeed, that's where my playground is. So facing the inner critic is one of the biggest hurdles that pop up in the process of getting to a breakthrough. And before anything else, I want to make very, very clear that you're never going to get rid of your inner critic. You're never going to dispel the shadow. You have to learn how to dance with the shadow. And this is where mindfulness is absolutely critical. There's few things will show you just how little control you have over your own mind, like spending just 10 minutes on a cushion. So in handling your inner critic, one of the first things to realize is that just because something is in your mind doesn't mean it's true. Learning to detach from thoughts, learning to realize that just because a thought or an emotion is in your head doesn't mean it's accurate, is really the first step towards freeing yourself from slavery to the inner critic, if you will. Does that make sense?
It does. I can relate a real life example of present day, where this is approximately show 570 we're recording today. And it's been 565 or so shows in a row, day after day, 7 days a week for, 565 shows. This week, we switched to a 5 day a week show, and my inner critic has gone berserk, saying,
yeah.
Oh my God, look what you've done. What's going to happen to people? The blah, 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 blah. And I've actually, yesterday, I had an enjoyable time after meditation going, this thing is nuts, but it's not me.
That's very good. One of the biggest tools in handling your inner critic is actually compassion. Compassion for the self that is suffering from the inner critic, but also compassion for the inner critic itself. Realize that the inner critic's job, what it's trying to do, is keep you safe. Now, yes. It might not have the best methods for that, but its intent is good. And if we're going to talk in terms of pure brain chemicals, what the inner critic activates is the sympathetic nervous system, which, despite its nice-seeming name, that's the fight-or-flight system that mm-hmm. sends adrenaline and all sorts of other nasty chemicals through your vein. When you access compassion, you access the parasympathetic nervous system, which sends a whole host of nice chemicals that give you a nice chemical wash and that quiet the sympathetic nervous system down.
That makes perfect sense. So I almost want you to repeat. No, I do want you to repeat how we should have I'll scratch that word from the record.
You're going to shit all over yourself.
Yes, let's not shit all over ourselves. But the idea that the sympathetic nervous system, our fear-based response, is actually something that's lovingly, even though it may not seem at that moment, trying to protect us and keep us safe. And so to bring kindness and compassion to that.
I think that both Judah and I have Jewish mothers, so the best example is imagine a Jewish mother who loves her kid to death, but that the way that she tries to keep them safe, the way she thinks that the best to keep them safe is to worry about them. Mm-hmm. And so the classic case of the Jewish mother sending a telegram saying, "Start worrying, details to come later."
Oh, God.
That's pretty much what your inner critic is doing 24/7. Stephen Hayes, in his fantastic book, Get Out of Your Mind and Into Your Life, has a very sweet quotation for you to imagine from your inner critic. Think of your inner critic as saying, "Hello, this is your inner critic. Do you realize that you should be worrying right now?" And that's what it's doing. It's just trying to keep you safe, except that the only tools the critic has is, of course, criticism. It's worry. It's anxiety. And so I don't know how familiar your audiences are, but this is where practices like metta first, mm-hmm. tonglen, if they're ready for it, and other similar emotion-based practices can be super helpful.
Tell us about metta first.
Metta is a wonderful entry point. And let me back up. For a lot of us, and myself included, who are far more comfortable in the nice, dry, comfortable cognitive realms of the mind, mm-hmm. Metta is horribly uncomfortable. I hate metta. Oh. It's a bit like what's the oil you're supposed to take? The
castor oil or something like that?
Yeah, or the fish oil you're supposed to take. I hate metta. It's uncomfortable. But metta is my saving grace. I would much prefer to spend my time in nice, dry, you know, vipassana or insight meditation. Mm-hmm. But that's not the muscles I need to work. What metta does is that it forces you to access compassion for yourself, for others, to access loving kindness. And these are muscles you may not have the habit to use. And I remember on my first metta retreat, I'm going to horribly paraphrase, I'm sure it's Thoreau or Emerson, who said, "I could feel my soul growing like corn in the night, and by God, it was painful." And I had the exact same feeling over those 10 days of pieces of my heart that had been like classical Chinese woman's feet that had been bound, and the unbinding can be just as painful. Well, pieces of my heart were regrowing, and by God, it was painful.
I want to use the term, I love that. I actually practice, I guess it'd be my own version of meditation during interviews, which is, it's crazy. I have a little quartz stone right here, a little crystal in my hand, and I'm always sending love to my guests through the meditation, through the interview. It becomes my meditation of that practice of connection.
So if you're looking at that, that's a genius tool for a couple of things. Metta, loving kindness, and altruism, which all are obviously very closely related. that has a host of good benefits. First of all, it's going to infuse your voice mm-hmm. with warmth and kindness, which is going to then in turn relax your interviewer. But in addition, altruism, loving kindness, metta, they're wonderful ways of combating uncertainty, which is one of the biggest blocks to breakthroughs. Because when you're focused on not your own performance, but on someone else's, and when you know that you're doing everything you can for them, it gives you something to cling on to. At least you know for certain that you're doing good as best as you can. Does that make sense?
That makes perfect sense. So,
metta. I was just going to say that if you look at some of the biggest breakthroughs and some of the examples we like giving in the book, Josh Balk's example with Hampton Creek, his biggest successive breakthroughs have all come through the combination of being stuck in a corner and having a sense of higher purpose. He's not working for him. He's working for the truly voiceless who are being tortured. And you combine that, the sense of higher purpose, with a sense of altruism, with a sense of needing to break outside of a box, and you get Hampton Creek.
And you call that the super tools as well, higher purpose, altruism, and then let's throw some meta meditation in there.
Absolutely, yes. We put those in a single chapter because, frankly, they started to arise in every single other tool that we were listing. So after a while, instead of saying, oh, and you can also, we just put them in their own chapter. If you were going to ignore all the rest of the book and just focus on those three, that would be the biggest quality of life improvement you could get of the entire book.
So we'll jump there in a minute. Before we do that, any other quick fixes you would give us for fear?
A couple, yes. So we've talked about compassion, mm-hmm. sending compassion for the scared self, sending compassion for yourself, sending compassion for whatever it is that's doing the fear. Acceptance is another really good one. Now, I know this is going to get controversial. CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, is mm-hmm. a wonderful tool. It's a spectacular tool. It has saved countless lives, myself, my own included. But there's a limit to it from what I and many others have found. Where CBT gets into trouble is that it asks you to dispute the thoughts. Mm-hmm. And in many cases, getting into a struggle with the thought that you're trying to avoid just, of course, makes it stronger. It's the white elephant / yellow Jeep problem. All the studies that they've done, if I tell you, whatever you do, don't think of a white elephant, the first thing you think of is?
Ooh, white elephant.
Yeah, there you
Sometimes
go.
Sometimes a yellow Jeep.
Yeah.
Or in my case, don't think of the black cat.
Or that one. Whereas what acceptance and commitment therapy, ACT, or mindfulness-based acceptance and commitment therapy, MBCT probably, and all sorts of acronyms, which I'm sure I'll mix up. But where the acceptance point comes in is that you don't try to fight the inner critic. Instead, you imagine wrapping it up with love. And one point I want to make clear here is that visuals affect the brain far stronger than words. They short circuit, they reach emotional centers of the brain way before words will. So in many cases, if the words of metta don't work, for me, for example, they really mean very little, try images. And imagine, there's two examples that I can give you. One is a wonderful, wonderful, my favorite metta meditation teacher, Michelle McDonald, who gave us an example. When she first started metta, she had a pretty rough life. And the only being in her life that she could imagine feeling safe giving or receiving love to or from was a teddy bear. And that's where I started. I actually, based on that, bought a teddy bear and started as that with my focus of metta. And I believe Sharon Salzberg gives another really useful example. which is if you're not yet comfortable.
I'm sorry, I'm laughing. I couldn't resist. 5 feet away, I was looking at it before the interview, and I had it on the ready, and I didn't know why, but my teddy bear. I said, you're supposed to have this for the interview.
Yep. Always trust your intuition. And so Sharon Salzberg School is, if you don't feel worthy yet of Meta, a good tool is to start with a being that you feel is entirely deserving of loving kindness. And of course, for a lot of us who practice meditation, the Dalai Lama is a great example of that. And so, of course, it's very easy to send loving kindness to him. Mm-hmm. And then put yourself into a unit with him and see if you can send loving kindness to the two of you as a unit. And then progressively, you'll be able to send loving kindness to the self.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. So let's talk briefly about the super tools. Let's dive in there. Then we'll do a few wrap-up questions and a brief meditation. Greatly, greatly enjoying this. It's super helpful information for people. Let's talk about super tool number one, a sense of higher purpose.
So this is the chapter that we opened with Joan of Arc. The reason we opened the chapter with Joan is because this is an extraordinary story, let alone what did or did not happen on the field of battle. And by the way, 13 to 16-year-old Joan really was in the middle of the battle and was shot with arrows, etc. The fact that an illiterate 13-year-old peasant girl, a girl, was able to not only leave her hometown, not only gain assistance to reach the French court, not only gain audience with the French king, all this was unheard of, but actually able to convince the king of France to send her to direct his army, all of that is just nuts. And none of it could have happened if she hadn't been, the girl was on fire. She truly believed that she was inspired by divine mission. And if you look at a lot of the most extraordinary breakthroughs and discoveries, a lot of time, I actually feel comfortable wild-ass guessing that 80% of the biggest discoveries that were actually sought, not the accidental ones, had a higher purpose to them. And one of the reasons, in my previous book, I studied charisma, one of the reasons that Steve Jobs is so charismatic is because Steve Jobs doesn't sell computers. He sells the promise of a better world. So a sense of higher purpose helps to combat all of the anti-breakthrough forces, the fear, the uncertainty, the internal criticism. If you can find a purpose greater than yourself, you're already one third of the way into the super tools.
And it doesn't have to be I'm going to save the world. It can be something on a much smaller scale, but if you can find that meaning in it.
Absolutely. If you look at Josh Balk, the example we give in that chapter, there was a perfect example of combining altruism and higher purpose. And if you'll forgive me for bringing up a slightly difficult subject, let me just ask you this. Mm-hmm. Would you take a baby chick, fully alive and conscious, put it in a blender and turn the blender on?
Myself, personally, no. I couldn't do that no matter what the mayo is involved.
Okay.
In fact, I make that joke, but since you started speaking for your portion of the interview, there have been the most beautiful birds chirping in the background.
Well, I'm sure they're approving of this. So I just want everyone to realize that every time you buy eggs, even organic ones, at the supermarket, you're paying someone else to do that for you. So this is one of the, it's not saving the world, but this is one of the outrages that Josh was working against. He felt that those baby chicks who have no voice, mm-hmm. but who are millions of them every year, ground up alive, fully conscious, those are the ones that he wanted to fight for. And so this led him to go from being in one box, trying to convince the big American corporations to treat their animals better, that didn't work because it would cost more. And that led him to the first breakthrough of, well, in that case, if we can't get them to treat their animals better, why don't we try to convince them to use alternative products that taste as well or even better, that are as good for the consumer or even better, and that are cheaper than what they use. So that was second try. Still didn't work. And finally, they said, let's just go completely outside the box. And essentially, that, let's start our own company. And they started Hampton Creek. Second big breakthrough happened when Hampton Creek got sued by Unilever, the biggest food-producing company in, I believe it's one of the biggest on earth, because their Just Mayo product didn't have eggs. Well, of course it didn't have eggs. That's the whole point of Just Mayo. Where they had a breakthrough is that they turned the situation around. Instead of seeing this as, oh my God, the biggest company on earth is suing us, we're going to die, they decided to look at it from, oh my God, the biggest company on earth is suing us. How could this be the best thing that ever happened to us? Well, it turns out it was. When they brought this to the public obviously took the side of David against Goliath. And Unilever started looking pretty bad for trying to shut down a tiny company on the basis of an antiquated, it was 1920s legislation. And I'll spare you the legal details, but Hampton Creek won. So to this day, they're one of the fastest growing companies. And I believe that Bill Gates called them something like one of the food companies that are going to revolutionize the next century. That's starting from, I don't want chicks to be mistreated, to let's revolutionize the way humans eat. Mm-hmm. And that's how higher purpose and altruism can get you there.
Woohoo! And saving the baby chicks, something very near and dear to my heart.
And mine.
Let's go from there and let's talk about super tool number three, meditation. And we had Chade Meng Tang on the show a while ago.
Oh, so Meng is one of my dearest and closest friends.
He is awesome.
Yeah. Have you ever met him in person?
I haven't, but we have the same agent for our books, and he's a very, very dear soul.
So if you ever see Meng in person, he just radiates this kind of goodness and this kind of bubbling joy that is just wonderful to behold. And you'll always feel higher on energy after you've hung out with Meng than before.
Very, very cool. So talk to us then about meditation or meditation and Meng and how this is such a powerful super tool.
Judah, would you mind taking the science on this one and I'll go into the practice?
So it's a fascinating situation because meditation itself, the majority of meditations, shut down the default network, which you might think is a problem when it comes to creativity and breakthrough thinking. However, meditation also strengthens or builds the gray matter in the default network. So it's almost like you're shutting it down to do maintenance and improvements so that when you turn it back on, it's that much more powerful. Other people I've spoken to, other neuroscientists who study these things, talk about how there's a possibility that you have a lot of breakthroughs sitting around that you can't see. It's almost like it's a pond and someone's thrown a stone in and you've stirred up the bottom, the muck, so you can't see. And what meditation does is it stills the pond and allows all the dirt to settle and allows you to be able to look all the way down to the bottom and see the breakthroughs, not that you're creating while meditating, but that are lying there already from previous work that you haven't been able to see.
I like that. And going along those lines, particularly the first one, I tell people it's like weightlifting with your brain. If you're weightlifting 24/7, your arms fall off. If you stop, you can actually build the gains from those pauses.
Exactly. Exactly.
So then did you want to jump in, Olivia, on the more on the meditation side of things?
I think that where I would encourage you to go is to, if we're going to do a meditation, to start with a modified version of metta, because that is for the many, many of us, and I'm sure many of your listeners, who are more comfortable with the nice, comfortable, dry realms of the mind. Metta is going to be the biggest out of your comfort zone experience in meditation. Tonglen, the compassion meditation is a wonderful, powerful tool. I personally, and this is just a personal thing, don't recommend Tonglen until you have a really strong metta practice, because in Tonglen you're taking on the sufferings of the world, and for people who already have a strong inner critic and who don't know how to handle it, that might not be the most helpful practice right away.
Gotcha. So I'd love to do a metta meditation with you. Before we do that, I want to actually double back real briefly to something we discussed off air at the beginning. I'm very curious. We had talked with Judah about who would do a meditation at the end, and he had mentioned something about a shamanistic practice, and I'm wondering how that fits in with creativity.
That's an excellent question. We're going to get a little funky. Is that okay?
Please do.
Okay.
Get so, funky, get jiggy.
Shamanism is a word that covers a broad swath of different indigenous spiritual practices from across the globe. So I just want to be very clear that I'm not speaking for the tens of thousands of different traditions that could fall under the rubric of shamanism. But one of the fascinating things is that cultures from all over the planet who never had any contact with one another have very similar ways of describing the world and of describing the different parts of the world. And many of them describe a lower world, a middle world, and an upper world. And that we live in a reality that some people might call ordinary reality that would be considered part of that middle section. But there's another side to that middle section, sort of a through the looking glass side. And in the lower world and in the upper world, only compassionate beings exist. And so a shaman is a person who can move between the worlds. And very often in more traditional cultures, shamans would journey into these other worlds to bring back knowledge, to bring back wisdom, to bring back healing, to bring back losses of power, losses of soul for the people in the community. And a lot of these traditions are being discovered, so to speak, by Westerners. And the fascinating part in terms of creativity is that in first allowing yourself to believe that there might be a different realm or dimension that you can access that is not necessarily material. That in and of itself is a plasticity exercise. But then to allow yourself that these journeys, which could be compared also to lucid dreaming or Carl Jung's active imagination, these are states, these are liminal states similar to being in a hypnagogic state or hypnopompic state. They're in between states where you are gaining access to other things. Now, depending on your orientation, you can just say that you're gaining greater access to the unconscious parts of your brain. Or if you're a little more woo-woo, you can say that you're gaining access to other dimensions of reality. I actually don't have a preference on what you call it. But the process itself opens you into a space that allows for the new and the novel and the unknown to come in.
Fascinating. Can you share with us real briefly, it's almost like doing a double meditation, I realize, but this dovetails so much with the automatic writing, which I'm teaching people. Can you share with us just briefly how we start to access that?
Very carefully, but my teacher right now is sitting somewhere going, do not do this quickly.
how many minutes would you need?
Oh, 10, not even. So you're going to want some kind of a sound driver, and you can just go on YouTube and type in shamanic drumming, and just sort of a very regular, steady drum beat will come up.
Yeah.
And the sound driver sort of helps to put you into a state that's more open to this. And then let's say you're going to the lower world. You want to imagine a place that you've been before, somewhere that you know very well on the earth, on the ground, a hole in the ground, a tree, a cave, a source of water, something like that. But somewhere you physically have been and you know, something that really grounds you. And one of the reasons we're very careful with this is because people can get lost and that doesn't go well. So you want to sort of leave a trail of breadcrumbs for yourself as you're going down. And as the drumming starts, you just start going down. You go into the water and down, or walk into the cave or down the hole or under the tree, whatever the case may be. And you just keep going until it sort of changes. It stops. Some people describe going through a tight space or a vortex. And then suddenly you pop out somewhere. And now, and just because it's called the lower world, it doesn't mean it looks like it's underground or it looks like hell or anything like that. It can look like the sky. It can look like this world. It's all whatever happens for you. And you can just ask yourself, I'm looking for a guide in animal form. And just look around and see what you see and keep walking and see if an animal shows up. And if it does, you can just ask it. You're like, are you my teacher? And it might actually say yes, like out of a cartoon, or it might just sort of make it clear that it is, or it might not and just run away. But the thing to keep in mind is that these teachers, A, they are compassionate, but B, they're not necessarily going to sit down and give you a teaching like in college. They might bite you. And in doing so, ask you to look at your relationship to fear. Mm-hmm. They might put you on their back and go flying with you and show you a higher perspective. They're very often going to speak in metaphor or symbolism, and so you have to be ready for that as well. And then, as the drum starts to end, you come back the way you came, and this is the breadcrumb part. You literally trace the steps all the way up and through and ending back where you were on the ground near the hole or the water or the tree or what have you. And that's just the simplest way in terms of finding a guide. But I just want to place a caveat that if this sounds really, really interesting to you, I highly recommend going and finding a teacher. Teachers are fabulous. There's a lot of shamanic teachers out there. You can find them online in lots of different places. But this is not stuff to be trifled with, and so teachers can be incredibly important.
Amen to that. Thank you for sharing. And we may have to have you back at a future time to talk more about this with us if you'd like.
I'd be happy to. Absolutely.
Would love that. So a few quick wrap-up questions, then we'll drive in and jump into that meditation. First off, what one homework assignment would you both give people today to cultivate their creativity?
Ooh. Homework assignment. Okay, I'll give this one. We use this one in the book, but it's really fun. With a group of friends, put forth this question. Imagine that gravity stops working after 10 p.m.
Cool.
and starts working again at 7 a.m. And now start imagining, what does the world look like? How have we evolved in the world given that there's this bizarre thing that happens at night? And just imagine what that world might look like.
Awesome. So next question is, what advice would you both give parents today to help their kids to cultivate creativity and breakthroughs in their kids?
Do your best to not worry about the quality of the output of the children. Don't worry that their inability to draw or dance or tell a story or what have you is somehow a reflection on you. Recognize that they are in their own process and simply encourage them to keep trying, to keep doing, to keep exploring. Cultivate in them curiosity and do your best to cultivate that curiosity without concern for how well they did, because the mastery will come later. But right now what they need is they need to build a sense in their own minds that being curious is its own reward.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. For both of you, I guess you'll have to answer individually, what personally brings you the greatest happiness, or what I call the woohoo factor?
I can, actually. It's a somewhat new activity in my life. It's only been a year and something. It's unfortunately a little bit of an addiction. I used to have a chicken addiction, and anyone who keeps chickens knows what chicken math is, but turns out there's something even worse. I now have a little bit of a bee problem, and bee math is exponentially harder to handle. So I started out with one hive, and now it's a varying number between 5 and 7, with at the height 50,000 bees on average in each. So I got a couple million kids now to take care of.
Woohoo! Awesome.
It really is fantastic.
And I can't think from a ecology of the planet of a better offspring to have.
I wish I could say that I was thinking of the ecology of the planet.
You're thinking when of the honey?
Well, honey was nice. When I started, I just thought it would be fun. And yes, there might be some honey. And yes, I might be doing something good for the planet. But very quickly, all those fell aside. And just the bloody fascination of a hive. It's one of those activities that you can start at 10 a.m. You're just going in for a few minutes. And next thing you know, you look up and it's nighttime already. And, you know, 8 hours have gone by. You haven't seen the time go. It's that kind of a, I mean, sometimes if you gave me the choice between beekeeping and sex, I'd have a hard time answering.
I don't know where to go with that, but it might save the planet. So, all right. And talk about being in flow and being in doing what makes your heart sing. So, Jonah, for you, can you top beekeeping and sex?
I never thought I'd be asking that either. I would definitely put sex on the list. But if we don't want to go there, it's not that type of interview. I would say dancing through the night. Dancing into dawn is probably one of the most flow-like experiences for me. It's this wonderful metaphorical journey, both about going into yourself and into the dark realms of yourself, as well as just sort of surviving difficult times, whatever they might be. And it's hard. It gets to be like 3:30, 4 in the morning, and you're dancing, and you're kind of tired, and you're cold, and you'd really just like to go to bed. But you know, you keep moving, and then there's this beautiful thing that happens with other dancers on the dance floor. It's like a dancing sangha where you're all in it together. So you're all encouraging and supporting each other. And then the sky starts to lighten and the first rays of the sun peek out and suddenly you realize you've made it. And there's this shift that happens and suddenly you're not tired anymore. Suddenly you are awake and alive in a way that you weren't when the night began. And suddenly, like, it's not that you're moving so much, but the movement you are making, it's almost like they are part of the flow. The flow is moving you as much as you are moving yourself. And I can just float on that for a very long time afterward, for days and days and days.
I love it. It actually, you brought me back in time to the first Native American ceremonies that I attended with the Navajo Nation. And it would be a sunset to sunrise drumming circle and chanting. And you all together had to stay awake through the entire process. And that 3:30 to 4 o'clock period is just brutally difficult to stay awake. But then as the day's first light, the purples on the horizon start to come up, your spirit starts to soar.
Yes, it's amazing.
Woohoo!
Woohoo!
So where can people go to find out more and to find your beautiful book?
The best place for the book is on Amazon. If you type the net and the butterfly, actually, apparently, if you just start typing the net and, it'll show up. And if you want to learn about us individually, there's a website, thebutterfly.net, and then we each have our own websites. Mine is askolivia.com, like asking a question, and Judah's is riverine.com. Judah, if you want to spell that.
Or it's probably easier to just say go to judahpollock.com, which will circle around to that as well. So,
I'll get links to both of them on our website. If people go to inspirenationshow.com, we'll get links to get you over there as well.
Thanks, Michael.
Certainly. Thank you. Any last words of wisdom you want to share before we do this meditation?
Well, I'm not sure these are words of wisdom, but the best advice I can give anyone is that when you get up in the morning, one thing that you can ask yourself is to imagine, once you've left this planet, if you look back onto this life. How would you like the world to be different because you have lived? And when you ask yourself that, that's a good way of finding a sense of purpose. And if you live your days by that, you will leave the world a better place, and you will feel that your life has had a meaning and a purpose.
Woohoo! And Jonah, anything you'd like to add to that?
If anybody's listening to this and telling themselves this is all well and good, but I'm not creative, or that there's something different about creative people, I just want to say that physiologically it's not true. Everybody has the same exact creative mechanism in their brains. Everyone, even if you're listening right now and saying, not me, actually, if I put you in an fMRI, there it would be. The difference is allowing ourselves to access it. The difference is allowing ourselves to partake in it. So the world is getting more complex. We need more people being creative together to solve these problems. We need you to allow yourself to access what is just lying there. It's a part of you. Allow yourself to engage it.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Before we jump into meditation, I gotta say this. I don't know any other way to say it, but I love you guys.
Thank you. We love you too.
We love you too.
You guys are awesome.
Thank you.
You should come hang out with the chickens and the bees and Judah's shamanic stuff.
I would be in heaven on all accounts. And throw in an occasional fMRI in there as well.
This has been an awesome interview. You've been great. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. Olivia, do you want to lead us in a short meta meditation?
Yeah, absolutely. So the visualization that we're about to do is guiding you through a slightly altered form of metta. Mm-hmm. And it has been crafted to take advantage of two distinct human tendencies, our absorption of images and our respect for authority. Throughout this exercise, you may notice a certain rhythm created by the repetitions, and that is their purpose, so just give it a try. So if you can sit comfortably or lie down and take a couple of deep breaths, and as you inhale, imagine drawing in masses of clean air towards the top of your head, and then let it whoosh through you from head to toe as you exhale, washing all concerns away. So breathe in masses of clean air. Breathe out. Let it whoosh through you and wash everything away. Think of any occasion in your life when you performed a good deed, however great or small. Just one good action, one moment of truth or generosity or caring or courage or compassion. Focus on that memory for a moment and feel the sensations. Now think of one being, whether present or past, mythical or actual, whether it's Mother Teresa, Buddha, Jesus, the Dalai Lama. This could be a person or a pet or even a stuffed animal, a teddy bear. Any one being that you could imagine could have great affection for you. Picture this being in your mind. Imagine their warmth, their kindness, and compassion. See it in their eyes and in their face. Feel their warmth radiating towards you, enveloping you. Now see yourself through their eyes with warmth, kindness, and compassion. Feel them giving you complete forgiveness for everything your inner critic says is wrong. You are completely and absolutely forgiven. You have a clean slate. All sins are washed away. Feel them giving you wholehearted acceptance. You are accepted just as you are right now at this stage of growth, imperfections and all. At this stage of growth, you are perfect. At this stage of development, you are perfect. At this stage of perfection, you are perfect. With everything that's in your head and heart, you are perfect. With all your imperfections, you are perfect. You are fully approved, just the way you are, at this stage of development, right now. And whenever you feel ready, you can open your eyes and come back to the present moment.
Woohoo! Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Much, both of you. This has been a treasure. Yes, I wasn't going for that word, but it has been a treasure and a treat.
Thank you. Same here.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you both so much. For everyone out there, this is Michael Sandler saying be well, have fun, get the net and the butterfly, and discover your own breakthroughs and shine bright.
Woohoo!
Thank you, guys.
And I just thought if you might get some strong reactions from readers regarding the baby chick thing and even organic. So I'll send you a link for anyone who has more questions. It's just a Wikipedia link explaining what chick culling is and how, yes, really, it is the standard method of disposing for baby chicks, even organic eggs. So that way, if they want to learn more, they can.
Thank you both so much. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep on shining bright. We support you. We support you. We support you.
Thank you. I'm going to say hi to my chickens because they've been missing me, I'm sure.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe, see the website. Thanks so much and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!